Hello everyone. Welcome to this presentation, which is called Participating in the Divine Mysteries, Psytrance Festivals as Gnostic Experiences. My name is Vedova, I am Greek, and tonight I'm going to share with you a story that starts from the very ancient times, runs through history, and culminates into our present gathering. Today, we are inaugurating a celebration, the celebration of the feminine in psychedelic trance culture. In Greek language, terms like creativity, imagination, fertility, sexuality, nature, art, technology, beauty, love, and life are all of a feminine gender, and so are the terms consciousness, gnosis, participation, and madness. I see these terms as representative aspects of the feminine and as characteristics of this gathering, because through our present meeting here at BOOM, we have the opportunity to experience them, to embody them, and to connect through them with the most inexpressible, hidden, and immaterial aspects of the world. And that is possible because psychedelic trance festivals employ a combination of a number of techniques, arts, and technologies, ancient and contemporary, for allowing us to come in contact with what is beyond ordinary perception, with the hidden, the transcendent, the divine, or the alien. When we meet the alien or the divine in the psytrance event, we are participating in the divine creativity and in the collective divine imagination, because psytrance invites us to co-create the sacred mystery of our present and our future, which at the very ancient times had been recognized and celebrated as the great goddess, as Mother Earth, and as nature herself. For centuries, the archetype of the goddess had been repressed in the collective unconscious and hidden in the most archaic domains of collective memory and history. But archaeological research conducted since the 19th and during the 20th centuries uncovered many findings of the prehistoric era, the period in human evolution before the invention of the technology of writing, which suggests that earlier societies identified the sacred mysteries of life and death with the feminine. In many late Paleolithic and Neolithic sites of Anatolia and old Europe, for example, archaeologists found a variety of female figurines with similar characteristics. They also uncovered and identified common symbolisms depicted on the walls and in artifacts coming from those sites, as well as similar geometrical patterns and designs. The same symbols and patterns are also displayed in archaeological sites of the Bronze Age Minoan civilization of ancient Crete, who was the last to worship the creative power of the universe in the form of the one great goddess. After the destruction of the Minoan civilization by a volcanic eruption, followed by a devastating tsunami at around 1450 before Common Era, and due to new power relations formed out of population shifting and mixtures in the Balkans, different male gods and goddesses gradually outplaced the great goddess. New religions emerged, but we still find some attributes of the earlier feminine power in the mix of and rites of different deities like Demeter, Hecate, Persephone, Aphrodite, and Artemis, until the 4th century, when Christianity, with the destruction of the Eleusinian mysteries, violently erased the last remaining traces of the ancient pagan knowledge of the great goddess. The Eleusinian mysteries had been celebrated for about 1,500 years every September in Eleusis, a place near Athens. Everyone was welcome to participate, regardless of class or gender, but only once in a lifetime. And what was actually taking place in the mysteries was a secret that, if shared, the price was death. But a few written accounts have given us some fragments of information about the mysteries, during which the myth of Persephone and her return from Hades with her newborn son were enacted. Persephone is daughter of Demeter. Demeter is the earth goddess of harvest and fertility, whom the Greeks inherited from the Minoans. The return of Persephone symbolized the eternal cycle of life, of death and rebirth, offering redemption for the world and to mankind. After entering the Great Hall of Initiation in Eleusis, the Telestirion, the participants experienced spectacular visions, phantoms and ghosts, spirits of Demeter and the spirits of Persephone with her son returning from the abyss of darkness. They encountered the hidden forms of the divine, which they understood through their common myths and their shared cultural symbols. They would come in contact with the archetypal images of the collective unconscious. They would confront their deepest fears and desires. Their ego would dissolve. They would symbolically die, and through a union with the divine and with the whole of existence, they would be reborn again, healed, transformed, and liberated, redeemed for this life and the other. There are evidence which suggests that before entering the Telesterion, the participants were administered a potion called Kikeon, which some researchers proposed was containing a psychoactive ingredient, like ergot of barley from which LSD is constructed, or some kind of a psychedelic mushroom or a white plant containing DMT. During the ritual, the participants were entering an altered state of consciousness, an ecstasy and a state of madness, invoked from the psychedelic capacities of the Kikeon, which they further combined with ritual dance, music, chanting, incense, vapors, and fire in a kind of a theatrical setting created for supporting the whole spectacular experience. According to the ancient Greek philosopher Plato, ritual techniques for contacting the transcendent can bring the person in a state of divine madness, which he particularly named the telestic madness. Madness in ancient Greece was not only connected with disease, but also with supernatural intervention, and Plato insisted that some kinds of madness are granted to people as divine gifts, and they benefit humankind. Divine states of madness are understood today through the notion of altered states of consciousness, which refers to psychological or physiological patterns or conditions that are different from a supposedly common ordinary consciousness state which we experience in everyday life while we are awake. Altered states of consciousness include, between others, daydreaming, sleep, flow, immersion, trance, ecstasy, and visionary experiences, or pathological states like schizophrenia or dissociation, or experiences interpreted as paranormal, spiritual, and mystical. Altered state of consciousness can be induced through different techniques like meditation, yoga, tantra, and holotropic breathing. They can also be induced through ritual methods and through practices like chanting, listening to music, and dancing. Or they can be induced through psychological techniques that activate the imagination and are used in art or for healing purposes, like Carl Jung's method of active imagination or hypnosis. Most effectively, altered states of consciousness are induced from the consumption of psychedelic substances, and they vary in intensity according to different parameters and individual expectations. What occurs during altered state of consciousness is an openness to images, to thoughts and ideas that arise from within the psyche, from the world, or from both. That happens because altered states of consciousness activate processes of the imagination and allow images of the unconscious and contents of the collective psyche to surface in mind and reveal themselves in consciousness. During altered state of consciousness, it is also possible to experience gnosis. Gnosis is a very special kind of knowledge, and that is because it can only be experienced directly. And it is so profound, felt in the deepest realms of the psyche, that it is salvational. It heals the soul, it liberates the mind, and it transforms the persons because it offers glimpses of eternity and of the hidden, immaterial dimensions to those who experience it. A gnostic experience occurring while in altered state of consciousness is a spiritual experience. Its contents cannot be understood through logic and reason, and they cannot be communicated through language. They are inexpressible, and the only way for consciousness to approach and articulate them is through symbols and through metaphor, and thus through art, myth, and fantasy. Divine states of madness correspond to different kinds of gnostic experiences. Because it is possible to receive gnosis while in a state, in an altered state of consciousness that is in a state of madness. According to Plato, except for the telestic madness, there exist three more types of divine madness. As I mentioned before, the telestic madness is invoked by a combination of ritual techniques, and it liberates the persons through collective ecstatic consciousness states that unite all the participants with each other as well as with the whole of existence. There is also the prophetic madness, in which a person gets filled with a divine power during a state of enthusiasmos. Enthusiasmos comes from the Greek word entheos, which means to be filled with a divine power, and it is today associated with spirit possession and states of trance and ecstasy. The term entheogen, which is another name for the psychedelic plant, also derives from the Greek word entheos, while the term psychedelic refers to that which manifests the psyche, the hidden in the psyche. During prophetic madness, a person acts as a medium between the material and, immaterial dimensions of the world, communicating divine knowledge to other people received in the form of visions or through channeling. There is also the poetic madness, coming as divine inspiration and as a gift from the muses that allows a person to create different kinds of art by participating in the divine imagination, through the unique individual imagination. And because the language of art is symbolic, the person that experiences poetic madness, the artist, can communicate through the medium of art fractions of the hidden spiritual realms in the minds of the other. Finally, Plato proposed the fourth kind of madness as the most beneficial of all. Love, which according to Plato, occurs when somebody sees beauty on earth and is reminded of the true beauty the human soul had encountered in the plane of truth before descending into the material body and this life. We could say that in the category of Gnostic experiences, if we can differentiate such a category, belong aesthetic experiences that take place when we encounter something beautiful and something symbolic, states of profound creative inspiration, visionary experiences during which we are co-creating immaterial and ephemeral images of alternate worlds, spiritual dimensions, or entities in an act of participation in the divine imagination through our own individual imagination, and finally, mystical experiences that in this presentation are understood as referring to the ultimate union with the divine, with the self and with the whole of existence, and to the union of body, mind, and spirit, through which the gnosis of oneness brings us in a state of love and eros. All these kinds of gnosis are possible to be experienced in a psytrance event, and more specifically in the dance floor, if we're aware of and unwilling to participate in it, in the event in a way that can actualize it as a divine mystery. But before I analyze the process taking place in the dance floor of a psytrance event as a spiritual process during which it is possible on the one hand to experience different qualities of gnosis and on the other hand to symbolically communicate the contents of gnosis through different technologies, arts, and through the body, I would like first to share with you briefly the historical background of gnosis, because the history of gnosis is a history untold, hidden and contested, and as we will further see, it is also connected to psychedelic trance. During the Hellenistic period and late antiquity that ends in around the 6th century Common Era, a number of Greek and Egyptian religious cults and group of men interpreted the teachings of Plato in a way that transformed them into a religious worldview with its own mythologies and ritual practices. These groups believed that Plato's teachings were not original, but that Plato was one in a long lineage of ancient sages, including Zoroaster, Hermes Trismegistus, and Pythagoras, who secretly transmitted ancient gnosis and spiritual wisdom coming from the East to their descendants. The central preoccupation of these groups, between them was Gnosticism, Hermetism, and Theurgy, had been the attainment of gnosis through the direct experience. But the Christian fathers of the time pronounced all these groups in heresy and charged their adherents to death. During the Dark Ages, gnosis was temporarily lost, as elite male priests assumed the roles of the gatekeepers of divine truth, keeping people in poverty, ignorance, and fear. different Christian intellectuals of the time learned and mixed into their theological and philosophical worldviews elements from these ancient pagan sources and the newly imported Jewish Kabbalah, resulting to the formation during the Renaissance and until the time of the Enlightenment of different magical traditions. These traditions developed secretly within an enchanted worldview. They were searching for spiritual knowledge of salvation by paying special attention on the direct experience of the hidden realms of nature through divine states of madness, through the practice of the occult sciences that include, between others, alchemy, astrology, and magic, and through the engagement with the powers of the imagination. These traditions are known as esoteric traditions because they were seeking the truth that comes from within, the esso, in contrast to the exoteric knowledge that comes from the exterior world, the exo. The term esoteric is also connected to secrecy, and it also refers to a universal gnosis that is regarded as being the same in the core of every religion and spirituality. The gnosis that we are one with the whole, that we are divine, and that we are participating in the divine mystery of evolution and of the cosmos, mentally and physically. So the invention of the technology of print and the ancient pagan wisdom transmitted through space and time in written form stand at the beginning of the modern world. Writing and print are media technologies. They carry and transmit information. From one perspective, everything we perceive and engage with in everyday life can act as a medium. Everything mediates information. Light, for example, is a medium without which we could not see objects and receive visual information of shapes and colors. Sound is a medium too. Radio, telephones, TVs, computers, and the internet are also media of communication, but man-made. They are technologies articulating through light, thoughts, images, knowledge, and contents of the mind in the rest of people. Every art is a medium, and we, as humans, are media too, that not only share information through body, action, language, style, and behavior, but who actually receive, process, and make meaning out of information when this is possible. And our responsibility is great because by using all other media, we further articulate information in the rest of the world, affecting everyday life and evolution in general, according to intention, will, and desire. Media technologies influence the way human beings operate in the world, as individuals and as a whole. The technology of writing and later of print, for example, enabled processes of analytical thinking to occur that are connected to the left hemisphere of the human brain, because they freed the mind from the constraints of memory keeping, so that more complex thought processes could be performed. Due to writing and print, it became possible to develop science, and to share information, to study the environment and the laws of nature, to configure encyclopedias and democratize knowledge, and of course to develop more advanced technologies. The scientific revolution took place between the 16th and 17th centuries, leading to the time of the Enlightenment, which is also known as the Age of Reason. During the Enlightenment, many intellectuals and group of men proposed that society and civilization should progress through reason and logic and not through faith and religion. They promoted the scientific method as the only valid approach to knowledge, and they rejected gnosis, magic, and any other knowledge claims that are based on direct experience and cannot be checked by others. The implementation of the ideas of the Enlightenment took place during the 19th and 20th centuries, triggering the rapid industrialization of the world through the exploitation of nature and the dominion of man on the planet with the help of technology. Science got elevated into a kind of religion, while the world was proclaimed as an objective external reality that progresses linearly and irreversibly through time according to cause and effect. No gods and, of course, no goddesses exist in this logical world whose properties can be approached and manipulated through the tremendous capacities of the reason of man and only for man, because man has a great ego and a great thirst for power and domination. And from there, what arises is not divine madness, but paranoia, as fanatism becomes the leading power of civilization, something proved in recorded history, in the recent history of the 20th century, during which world wars and atomic disasters took place, and something which is further obvious in our current global condition. The victory of reason was a victory of a standard way for explaining all aspects of the world in terms of cause and effect, a way which is known as causality. But when we accept causality as the only logical explanation of how the world works, then we exclude so many aspects of human experience that come from intuition, imagination, emotions, intentions, fears and desires, all of which also co-shape our understanding of reality. What we exclude can be named participation, another way for understanding the world, which does not reject processes of reason and logical thinking, but which is based on direct experience. Participation uses all the attributes that makes us humans for making meaning in the world. The whole body, all the senses, all the different states of consciousness, and most importantly, our powers of intuition and imagination. Through participation, the world is experienced as a mystical unity and a divine mystery in which everything is linked through analogies and correspondences. This world is alive, conscious and sacred, and everything participates in it. Everything takes part in its co-creation. And I'm not talking only about participation in the physical, corporeal dimensions of reality, but also for participation in the various hidden, unconscious dimensions of the world. These hidden aspects of the world can be experienced directly, and through the direct experience, it's possible to receive gnosis. Because participation arises from gnosis, and the experience of gnosis affirms participation as a valid way for operating and understanding the world. Its repression from the dominant forces of society and causality has resulted in our dysfunctional human condition, but the induction of participation through gnosis, attained by common intention in an act of communication with what is beyond ordinary perception, is possible to realign ourselves and our civilization with the evolution of the cosmos, because through participation, it is possible to mentally and physically co-create the present and the future by revealing gnosis to consciousness and by actualizing the contents of gnosis in our material world through body, action, and through different media. But let's go back for a while to see what happened to esotericism since the Enlightenment and how participation as a valid orientation towards existence developed. At the time of the Enlightenment, some other groups of European artists and intellectuals that are known as the Romantics combined earlier esoteric worldviews with art and philosophy, praising the powers of the imagination as a means for achieving enlightenment. Because for the Romantics, enlightenment could be attained by diving into the night side of nature, in dreams and in images arising from the dark depths of existence. And for traveling into the night side of nature, the Romantics combined esotericism and art, and they used a number of techniques for activating altered states of consciousness and attain gnosis through the imagination. In Greek language, the word imagination is fantasia. The term fantasia comes from the Greek word phos, which means light. Originally, imagination is connected to light because, on the one hand, and as the Greek philosopher Aristotle explained, the initial images of the imagination come from what we see in the exterior world. In its Latin version, imagination is also connected to image because vision is connected to light. Without light, we cannot see. So imagination creates images, and thus it creates light, and very interestingly, imagination is also connected to magic. For the Romantics, imagination is the divine imagination, the cosmogonic creative power of existence. Human imagination, as a faculty, is for the Romantics a divine medium, through which we are able to participate in the divine imagination, in the divine creativity, by giving shape and form to what exists in the immaterial or spiritual dimensions of the world. Some Romantics passionately argued that through our will and our intention in an act of communication with the transcendent and the hidden forces of nature through the powers of our imagination, we can co-create the forms of the collective psyche and the contents of the collective unconscious, the archetypes. And then through the physical body, through different media, and especially through the symbolic language of art, were able to bring these fragments of the divine imagination, this gnosis, back to the material everyday world and communicate them indirectly. And so this way, we as humans can participate in the co-creation and actualization of the cosmic evolution of the universe and in its manifestation in the physical realm here on Earth. The Romantics were expressing a worldview based on participation, and inspired from their ideas, many modern art movements developed, like the Symbolists and the Surrealists. While today, the visionary art scene continues this romantic function of the artist, who as a mystical journeyer, traveling in the depths of the unconscious, manifests and articulates divine knowledge to the rest of people through the medium of art. After the Romantics, participation in esotericism continued to spread as the occult, which tried to unite science and spirituality through the direct experience of gnosis. It took the form of actual organizations, and it continued to use and develop earlier esoteric practices for contacting the transcendent and expressing it through literature and art, in which we find the roots of psychoanalysis, psychology, and later parapsychology that developed in our secularized society as a legitimate way for coming in contact with what is hidden in our psyche. Examples of the occult are the Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn, the Theosophical and Anthroposophical societies, Spiritualism, Freemasonry, and people like Aleister Crowley, George Ivanovich Gurdjieff, Dion Fortune, Kenneth Grant, and many, many others. During the 20th century, the occult continued to expand, becoming more and more popular under the influence of new theories in psychoanalysis and the unconscious, new scientific developments, new archaeological research, newly imported information from different world religions and practices, the impact of world wars, and of course the articulation of different media technologies in society, like the telephone, the typewriter, the gramophone, cinema, and later radio, television, and the personal computer. One moment, please. During the 1950s and 1960s, the invention of the technology of LSD triggered the psychedelic revolution. Psychedelics evoked mass altered states of consciousness and direct experiences of gnosis. Different artists and intellectuals of the time explored and underlined the spiritual potentials of these substances, while more recently, Terence McKenna proclaimed psychedelic plants as the most direct portals to gnosis. The psychedelic revolution affected a big expression of participation in Western civilization, and gradually new kinds of spiritualities developed and spread based on the direct experience of the hidden realms of nature and of the self. In these spiritualities, we can find a creative combination of knowledge and imagination coming from psychedelic experiences, from arts, science, and science fiction narratives, from different worldviews and symbolic systems, from conspiracy theories, from different media technologies, different psychological methods, and different esoteric practices. All these spiritualities are enveloped in a cultural environment full of contemporary mythologies that have common characteristics and which mix the occult and the paranormal, the imaginative and the fantastic, the organic and the technological, the alien and the archaic. Alternative spirituality movements include, between others, the New Age, Neopaganism and Technopaganism, Eco-spirituality and God-spirituality, Neo-shamanism and Techno-shamanism, and Theogenic Esotericism and Psychedelic Trance, which mixes and expands aspects of all the other spiritualities that I just mentioned. In the end of the 1960s and during the 1970s, many people who took part in the psychedelic revolution went to India and to other places in the world searching for direct spiritual experiences and for an understanding of them through non-Western philosophies and religious views. During the 1980s, psychedelic trance was born, which today has developed into a multicultural, transnational and global movement that combines so many techniques and knowledge inherited and developed since ancient times for contacting the transcendent and experience gnosis, while it also offers through different arts and contemporary media technologies opportunities for expressing and communicating gnosis symbolically. What is taking place in the dance floor of a psytrance event is a spiritual process that I have named technognosis, and which combines the gnosis of technique, art and technology, which in Greek derive from the same root and describe ways for manifesting the hidden, with the notion of gnosis. Technognosis suggests that the intentional combination of different arts, techniques and technologies can affect a plurality of alterations of in consciousness that allow us to participate in the divine imagination and experience gnosis. During this process, we are invited to co-create the contents of the collective psyche by collaborating with the hidden forces of nature. And then, through the body, technological media, and through art, we are able to manifest and communicate symbolically the contents of our experiences in order to reveal fragments of the collective imagination, the self, our origins, and our future. I propose that if we all consciously participate in the technognostic process in the dance floor, then it's possible to collectively actualize the romantic function, become artists of life, and adopt participation as a way of existence. And now I will briefly explain how technognosis works through the experience of different degrees of gnosis. How technognosis works in the dance floor, and I will start from the aesthetic experience. The aesthetic experience occurs when someone encounters something beautiful and something symbolic. It can be nature, a living creature, or a work of art. So when we look at nature or at a work of art, we can try to understand what we experience, if we like it or not, if we find it beautiful or not. When we find something beautiful, we get a feeling of pleasure, which is known as aesthetic pleasure. The aesthetic pleasure can result in the aesthetic experience, a kind of a gnostic experience, according to how much we want, we intend to find a meaning in what we experience by getting very much involved in imagination, in feeling, in intuition, in emotion, and in thought. The beautiful and the symbolic can mediate gnosis because they do not have an agreed upon reference. They do not mean something specific. Everyone who sees something beautiful and something symbolic has to complete through the imagination a meaning in it. So this image, for example, this image may mean something different to each of you according to your experiences, your beliefs, and your personal images. But when the beautiful and the symbolic are intended to communicate gnosis through beautiful common symbolisms, for example, then the meaning they carry corresponds to a fragment of gnosis. By immersing ourselves in what we encounter, and by engaging the powers of the imagination, we are able to find a deep shared meaning in the beautiful and the symbolic that comes from the divine imagination, through nature, through humans, or through art. And we will comprehend this meaning only through the individual imagination in which images and experiences of the world and society exist. So the aesthetic experience is realized through imaginative participation. Psychedelic substances have also the capacity to induce the aesthetic experience because they reveal the beauty of nature. In the dance floor, all media can express the beautiful and the symbolic because the dance floor is a live art installation, a ritual space, a dance temple, and a kind of a theatrical musical performance in which everything and everyone participates. Music, artistic images, ritual objects, the natural environment, digital media, and we as humans, our clothes, our playful objects, the way we dance, the way we smile, and the way we behave, all invite for the aesthetic experience because through beauty and their symbolic character, all media, according to intention, can mediate gnosis. And then we have the visionary experience. Visions are induced during altered states of consciousness evoked by psychedelic substances that activate the imagination, but also by the music. In esotericism, music is viewed as mediating between the spiritual and physical realms because as a medium, it is immaterial and it is experienced directly through the whole body. In the dance floor, music guides the collective visions and influences the contents of them through rhythm, psychedelic electronic sounds, vocals that communicate spiritual knowledge from world religions, and samples from science fiction films. Again. Music sets a collective mood. It offers a road for consciousness to follow, and it also aids in traveling from one consciousness state to another, from one alternate reality to another. Through the phenomenon of synesthesia, during which information received from one sense can be translated through the imagination's information received from another sense, music can also be perceived in visual forms. In the dance floor, sounds are experienced as visual movements, as vectors and colors that create or reveal different dimensions of the environment which extend the 3D perceptual space. Visual media like screens, projections, lasers and lights further expand the physical space, while taking together all the media in the dance floor, including ourselves, co-create an alternate reality and the different time-space continuum in which individual visions and blend with all the other symbolic images around. And when we participate in the dance floor with the intention to reveal the hidden forms of nature, when we invite nature to participate in our own imagination, then the musical visions is possible to become divine visions and communicate gnosis. And what is then actualized in the dance floor is a technognostic visionary performance, a mix of theater, ritual, play, and life that manifests the collective divine imagination through everyone and everything present in a space where we all co-create the here and the now, expressing hidden aspects of the world through individual imagination, body, art, and media, and thus through physical participation. And I'm sorry, I had like many more pictures and slides to show you, but I don't know what happened. The gnosis of oneness is the most profound gnosis, because from there arises love, and from love emerges participation. In the experience of oneness, the actualization of the romantic faction manifests a purpose, why we are here and what we can do while being here. I believe that we are here to co-create reality by participating in the divine creativity and in the sacred mystery of life, and to manifest through the beautiful, which is also the ethical, the past, the present, and the future. We are here to realize the divine imagination in the physical realm of existence through body, arts, and media, and to evolve with the universe into the future. We have the knowledge, we have the technologies, we have the media, we have the ability to become a hyper civilization, and it is we that exist today. We are the inheritors of the past and the creators of the future. 2 years ago, Boom celebrated the alchemical transmutation that symbolically inaugurated the new age for humanity. And today, we actualize the new age by celebrating the feminine and the divine creative imagination. It is time to choose and evolve as species with nature, and it is up to everyone to co-create with her different aspects of existence. So let's trance and experience gnosis, and let's manifest the fruits of gnosis right here and right now. I wish you all a beautiful festival. Thank you very much.